Hello friends, once again welcome back to Core Chemical Engineering channel. So today in this video I'll discuss about the chapter transportation and metering of fluids, okay, from the fluid and particle mechanics subject. Okay, so in that I'll tell you about pipes, fittings and valves, what are all these. Then after that I'll discuss about fans, blowers and compressors. Then after that measurement of fluids, okay. Under that I'll tell you about full bore meter and insertion meter. Okay, so that's all what I'm going to discuss in this chapter. Okay, but basically in this tutorial I'll discuss about the three topics. First one is the difference between pipe and tubing. Okay, then after that schedule number, what is the significance of schedule number, and what kind of gate questions they asked based on the schedule number in the gate exam. Okay, then after that joints and fittings. So what are the role and importance of joints and fittings in the piping and erection in an industry. Okay, so let's discuss now. So here you can see transportation and metering of fluids. Okay, so transportation of fluids, both liquids and gases. So transportation of fluids includes for both liquids and gases. Okay, and here in this video I'll tell also about the common method for measuring flow rate. Okay, so first of all, as I said earlier, I'll discuss about pipe fittings and valves. So in that, first of all, the difference between pipe and tubing. Okay, so if you go in any industry, you'll see the most of the process fluids or utilities or steam are traveling through the pipes only. Okay, but in case of a tube, if you see, tubes are like a very small diameter tubing, okay, and that can be used for the instrument air, supply of instrument air, okay, in the control valve, or for the steam tracing around the pipeline, okay, for the conservation of heat in the pipeline, okay, for the process fluid. So let's discuss the points here. First of all, pipe. Okay, so a pipe is usually heavy walled. Okay, then pipes are available in large diameter, moderate length of 20 to 40 feet. Okay, so mostly pipes are available in large diameter, but length would be small. Okay, it would be like 6 feet, 12 feet, 12 to 40 feet. 40 feet is like a max, kind of max you can assume. Then metallic pipe can be threaded. Okay, then slightly rough wall pipes are slightly rough walls. Okay, and pipes can be joined by flange, screwed or welded fittings. Generally in the pipes there are two pipes, like pipes comes in the form of spools. Okay, if you involve in the commissioning of a job, then you will see that spools are being connected by the welding. Okay, that welding can be the golden joint, or you can say the butt weld. Okay, and there are different tests for those joints for checking the integrity of the welding. Okay, so those things I'll tell when I'll be discussing about the practical experience related to industry, but as of now I am focusing on the theoretical aspects. Now you see the tube. So tubes are basically thin walled and coil several up to 100 feet long. Okay, it can be 100 feet long. So then after that cannot be threaded, pipes cannot be threaded. Okay, and tubes cannot be threaded. Then after that smooth valves, tubes are having smooth valves, and they can be joined by compression or flare fittings. Okay, so now we'll discuss material of construction. So it can be PVC, steel, iron or glass or acrylic or PMMA, anything like that. Okay, we can use these materials for the making of pipes and tubings. Okay, now specifications. Pipe and tubings are specified in terms of their diameter. Okay, then after that in terms of the diameter, wall thickness and material of construction, these are the three things are being used for the specifications of pipes and tubings. Okay, so nominal diameter corresponds to actual diameter, and you know that generally in US they use the nominal diameter. Okay, and that nominal diameter corresponds to actual diameter when your pipe length, pipe dia is greater than 12 inch. Okay, but in case if your nominal diameter, given nominal diameter, is less than or equal to 12 inch, okay, it is not equal to outer diameter. Okay, so you can, if you are using 8 inch pipe or 6 inch pipe, then if it is given in terms of the nominal diameter, okay, then that nominal diameter will not be equal to their outer diameter, okay. Now after that, very important thing that I'm going to discuss here is schedule number, okay. So schedule number is equal to 1000 into internal working pressure divided by allowable stress, okay. So whenever a fluid is flowing into the pipe, there will be, that will cause the fluid pressure, okay, axial in the pipe, in the system, piping system, okay. So you have to use that pressure, internal working pressure. What is, suppose if you are using a steam line, so there would be a PG pressure gauge, or you know, PI, okay, pressure transmitter. So in that you can see the pressure, okay. So that pressure actually we are using in the, as a internal working pressure, then divided by the allowable stress. So what is the allowable stress for that into 1000, it will do, we'll get the schedule number, okay. I'll discuss the importance of schedule number, okay, later on. Now standard dimensions of steel, there are two standard dimensions we use. So first is IPS iron pipe size, then NPS is normal pipe size, okay. So 2-inch nickel IPS size correspond to nickel pipe having same diameter of 2-inch steel pipe, right. Now the important thing that I told you that I'm going to discuss was the schedule number. So wall thickness of a pipe is indicated by the schedule number, okay, which increases with the thickness, okay. Suppose a pipe, okay, a pipe is given as a 8-inch pipe, okay, having the schedule number 10, 20, 30, 40, okay, then how will you say that which one is having higher thickness, okay, higher thickness of the pipe? So the pipe which is having the higher schedule number will have a higher thickness, okay, but the internal diameter would be less for the higher higher schedule number pipe, okay. So suppose I am taking a 40 schedule number, 80 schedule number and 120 schedule number pipe, three pipes, okay, of having 8-inch, then the internal diameter for the 40 schedule number would be higher, okay, would be higher than the 80, than the 120, okay, but the thickness of the pipe would be higher for the pipe having 120 schedule number up before that, then 80 schedule number pipe will have a higher thickness than the 40 schedule number pipe, okay. So this is the generally in the piping is being decided by their schedule number. Pipe thickness is being decided by the schedule number, and that schedule number can be calculated using this formula, okay. So I guess one or two times in the GATE exam they had asked the question based on the schedule number, and that was basically diameter, about the diameter and the thickness only. Now tubing, okay. So the size of a tubing is indicated by the outside diameter. Wall thickness is ordinarily given by the VWG Birmingham wire gauge number, which ranges from 24 very light to 7 very heavy, okay. So if for a tubing VWG is given as 24, then it will be very thin, and suppose it is given as a 7, then that tubing would be very thick, okay. So as VWG increases, the thickness decreases, okay. What happens in case of tubing, as BWG increases, see, if it is having 24, then thickness is less, but if BWG is 7, the thickness is higher. But in case of schedule number, it is opposite. As schedule number is increasing, then your thickness is increasing, okay. Now let's discuss about the selection of a pipe, okay. So it is depend on the cost of the pipe and fitting, and cost of energy needed for the pumping of fluid, okay. So cost of the pipe and the annual capital charge is proportional to the pipe diameter raised to the power 1.5, okay. Now after that, if while power cost for turbulent flow, but for the turbulent flow the power cost would be proportional to the diameter of the pipe raised to the power minus 4.8, okay. Now if you want to calculate the optimum pipe size, then you have to draw the curve. So cost versus dia. So first of all, you have to plot with respect to the cost of the pipe and annual capital charge. So as the diameter is you're increasing, then your cost is increasing 1.5 times, right? But with respect to the pumping up fluid, the cost will decrease, okay, with respect to the diameter. So the point where it is going to intersect, okay, would be your optimum diameter, okay, for the selection of pipe, right? So this is how you can select the diameter of the pipe. Now, for turbulent flow of liquid in steel pipes larger than in 1 inch in diameter, the optimum velocity is B optimum is equal to 12 m dot raised to the power 0.1 divided by rho raised to the power 0.36, okay. So B optimum is equal to optimum velocity, it is in feet per second, m rod is equal to mass flow rate lb per second, then rho is equal to fluid density lb per feet cube, okay. So for water and similar fluids, B optimum is 0.9 to 1.8 meter per second. And for air or steam at a low to moderate pressure, B optimum is 6 to 24 meter per second. Now let's discuss the another important aspects is joints and fittings. Okay. So thick wall tubular products are usually connected by screwed fitting, by flanges or by welding. Okay. Now pieces of thin wall tubing are joined by soldering or compression or flared fittings. So this is how tubes are being connected, okay. Now pipes. Pipe is made of brittle material such as glass or carbon or cast iron, is joined by flanges or bell and spigot joints, okay. So pipes are usually connected by flanges or by welding. So what are flanges? Flanges are matching discs or rings of metal bolted together and compressing gasket between their faces, okay. So now generally by reading you cannot like understand, okay, those joints and you know about the flanges and the gasket until unless you see in the industry, you won't be having that much idea, okay. So I'll tell in brief, okay. So flanges are basically matching disc, okay. So if you connect the matching disc without putting the gasket, okay, what will happen? It will create a leakage whenever the process fluid is flowing through that pipeline and pipe is connected by the flange. If you are not putting the gasket in that, then definitely there will be a leakage because it can't seal if gasket is not there, then there will be a leakage because matching disc, if you are connect together, then it cannot make a proper sealing, okay. And if the system is having high pressure, suppose 20 kg per centimeter square or 35 kg per centimeter square pressure is there in under the pipeline, then definitely there would be a leakage, okay. So in order to avoid that leakage, we put the gasket, and that gasket must be having a rating, okay, pressure rating. Suppose 150 pressure rating PSI or 300 or 900 PSI rating gaskets comes in the market, and that be fixed according to the flange rating, okay. So we put in that, then after that we tied the flanges, and then after that we do the further torquing in order to arrest the leakage, okay. So this is how pipes are being connected, okay, in the industry. Now a flange with no opening used to close the pipe is called a blind flange, okay. Generally what happens in a pipe, generally there would be LPD, okay, low point drain or high point bend would be there, okay. In that there would be a one valve, okay. After that we put as another flange which is not having the hole, and after valve there is a flange, then again flange, and we put the gasket in that and put the bolt in that, okay. So and after tightening, so the flange which is not having any opening and seal the flanges, that flange is called as blind flange. Sometimes we call it as a end flange in the industry, okay. Generally it is famous as a end flange, okay. A normal flange is, okay, basically one spool is connected to the another spool, okay. Suppose there is a control valve is there, okay. So before that, control valves, you can control valve flange, and then another pipe flange would be there. So if you want to connect those two, and that control valve will come into the line, then that flange is basically normal flange which is being used for the connecting the pipelines or spools, okay, or any equipment. Now allowances for expansion, okay. So generally pipes are connected to varying temperature, it causes pipe to expand or contract. If pipe is rigidly fixed to its support, it may tear, loose, bend or even break, okay. So generally what happens when we are do the commissioning of a plant. Okay, so pipes are it would be at like pipes would be at the temperature of normal temperature. Okay, normal ambient temperature 27 degrees Celsius. Suppose at the time of commissioning, okay, if you are going to charge the steam or any process fluid having temperature 230 or 250, whatever the temperature would be there, then it will be because of the thermal, like pipes is going to in touch with the fluid having the 150 temperature. So it will cause the pipes to expand based on this thermal coefficient, okay. So if the pipes is getting expand and contract, and if we are going to put that pipeline with the rich support, then it will cause the support to breakage, okay. If support is not going to get breakage, then it may lead to the damage of the mother pipeline, okay. Therefore, fixed supports are not used. That is the only reason we are not putting the fixed support. It is based on the sometime the pipeline in the pipe rack would be rested on the, you know, the just base plate, or sometime it will be supported by using a trunnion support, okay. There are many T supports, there are many different types of support. Regarding the support, you can watch many videos on YouTube, or if you get a chance to go into the industry for industrial training or anything, you can ask there what are the supports, they'll show you simply. Then you can understand it like very nicely. So provisions is also made in all high temperature lines for taking up expansion with the help of bend or loops in the pipe by packed expansion joints, by bellows or packless joints, or sometimes the flexible metal hose, so that fittings and valves are not put under the strain, okay. Now, prevention of leakage around moving parts is done by stuffing boxes and mechanical seal, okay. Suppose if you have a compressor or a pump, okay, in that case, okay, that leakage is being arrested by using the stuffing box or mechanical seal, okay. So generally, pump or compressor discharge high pressure, okay, it takes the suction at the low pressure and discharge fluid at the high pressure. In that case, if there won't be any mechanical seal, then mechanical seal basically is being used for the, you know, having the grooves in the pipelines, okay, and that seal is being used to reduce the pressure in the discharge of the compressor, okay, so that after that we put the sealing fluid, then so that it can arrest the leakage, okay. Now first of all, now here we'll discuss about the stuffing boxes. A stuffing box is an assembly which is used to house a gland seal, okay. It is used to prevent leakage of fluid such as water or steam between the sliding and turning parts of the machine element, right. Now mechanical seal is a device that helps join system together by preventing leakage, okay, in the plumbing system. Containing pressure excluding contamination. If effectiveness of seal is dependent on the adhesion in the case of sealant and the compression in the case of gaskets, okay. So gasket is also one kind of mechanical seal, okay. What happens between the flange, we put the gasket, then after that we put the stud and bolt in that, nut bolt in that, okay, and then we tight it. And if we tight the flanges after putting the gasket in that, after tightening both flanges will get tightened. Sometime we do the torque tightening also if in case the leakage is not getting arrested. Now gasket, okay. A gasket is a mechanical seal which fills the space between the two or more matching surfaces generally to prevent leakage from or into the joint objects while under compression, okay. So that's what I told you about the gasket only. Now valves. The purpose of valve is to slow down or stop the flow of the fluid. Regarding the valve, I had already made one video, okay, for the detailed descriptions of the gate valve, globe valve, butterfly valve. I'll give the description of those that video link in the description box. From there you can click and watch, okay. So generally in this tutorial I'm gonna tell in the brief about the gate and globe and the butterfly valve, okay. So gate and globe valve. In a gate valve, the diameter of opening through which the fluid passes is nearly the same as that of the pipe, and direction of fluid does not change, okay. So as a result, a wide open valve results only a small pressure drop, okay. So gate valves are not recommended for controlling flow and are left fully open or fully closed. Generally, gate valves like are fully open or fully closed, used for the isolation or lineup of the process fluid. Sometimes we throttle, we charge the line by throttling, we like 1 thread, 2 thread, we open the gate valve, and after the charging, we'll open the full valve. Okay, so we can control the valve like we can control the flow like by throttling, like during the initial startup or shutdown. Okay, we can control the flow, okay, by throttling the gate valve also. But for controlling purpose, actual like automation, we use the only control valve. Okay, gate valves are not recommended. Gate valves are being like operate manually. We operate it from the manually for the isolation. Now, globe valves are widely used for controlling flow, and it is being used in the control valves also. The opening increases almost linearly with the stem position, and what wear is eventually distributed around the disc. The fluid passes through the restricted opening and it changes direction several times. It makes a 90 degree turn, okay? As a result, the pressure drop in this kind of valve is higher. So in the case of globe valve, the pressure drop is higher, right? Now plug and ball valves. So for temperature below 250 degrees Celsius, metallic plug cocks are used in chemical process lines. A quarter turn of the stem takes the valve from fully open to fully closed. When it is fully open, the channel through the plug may be large as the inside of the pipe, and itself the pressure drop is minimal in case of plug flow also. In ball valve, the sealing element is spherical, and the problem of alignment and the freezing of the element are less than with the plug valve. So in case of ball valve, when it is quarterly turns, if the hole of the ball valve match with the diameter of the pipe, then fluid flows through that, and if you quarter turn that, then the sealing element of the, you know, the sealing element of the spherical part which is not open comes along the flow direction of the pipe. In that case, it will get closed. Okay, now check valve. So a check valve permits flow in only one direction, that is we call an RVOK in industry, non-return valve. It is opened by the pressure of the fluid in the desired direction. When the flow stops or tends to reverse, the valve automatically closes by gravity or by spring pressing against the disc. So check valves or an RV plays a very, very important role in an industry, okay, for the safety purpose. Okay, suppose we don't want the process fluid of the downstream will come back into our system. In that case, we put the check valve, okay, for the safety measures, okay, and the controlling of our unit. So guys, that's all about today's video. Okay, so as I said, what I'm going to discuss in this video, I had told you. So guys, if you do like this video, please subscribe, share, and let me know into the comment box if you want to give any feedback. So guys, don't forget to share and subscribe. Thank you so much.